Dr. Nikki Greene is in Massachusetts, and Abby King is in Vienna, Austria. So we are all over the US and Europe here to celebrate the life of Moe Brooker. Musa, it's so nice to see you. I'm so glad to see you after seeing you at the memorial. Welcome everybody. I think we're all really, really happy to be here today. We're gonna do introductions and everything, but one of the reasons we do it this way at PAFA is we like to see people, and we'll make sure we have time for people to talk at the end of the session.
Yeah. Oh, I see one of my former students. Hi, Imani. And my cousin.
Oh, nice.
I love that. I love how even though Zoom is not ideal in a lot of ways, I would love to be in a room and getting everyone's energies. But, you know, we'll settle for this.
Well, and with that, we're going to jump in just to make sure we have time to hear from not only our amazing speaker, but also any of you who want to share things. Welcome. I'm Abby King. I'm the host today. And just wanted to thank you all for being here for our very special Art at Noon honoring PAFA alum Moe Brooker. Today's program, The Soul is the Body of the Spirit, features Dr. Nikki Greene and my colleague, Anna Marley, who's going to be introducing our speaker in just a second. But before we get to that, I wanted to respectfully acknowledge that our institutional host, the Pennsylvania Academy of the Fine Arts, is on the ancestral lands of the Lenni Lenape people, whose presence and resilience in Pennsylvania continues to this day. I also wanted to thank the folks who make free programs like this happen. The spring's Art at Noon lectures are supported by the Lefko family in memory of a beloved member of the Docent Corps, Mildred T. Lefko. So just a couple things before I hand things over. We are recording today's event, so if you know of anyone who couldn't be with us today, know that we'll be sharing that on PAFA's YouTube channel later this afternoon, your all's time. And I'll drop a link to where our library of recordings are in just a moment. Our speaker is going to be sharing her screen momentarily, but we will, as Dr. Marley mentioned, we will have time at the end for questions. So feel free to put things, comments, thoughts, resources in the chat. We'd love to hear from you. That's why we do it in a space where we can see you, where we can hold space together. So know that we will have a few minutes at the end for that. And I also wanted to put in a plug for some other programs we have coming up. Our next Art at Noon is going to be on March 30th. With the National Portrait Gallery curator, Dr. Dorothy Moss, who's gonna be looking at the life and work of Hung Liu. So we hope you can join us, and I'll also be dropping a link to our events channel, our events calendar, for more information on what's happening. I'm now so delighted to hand things over to my colleague, the Vice President of Museum Research and Scholarship, the Kenneth R. Woodcock Curator of Historic American Art, and the director of the Center for the Study of the American Artist, Dr. Anna O'Marley.
Thank you, Abby. It's so great to be with you all again here today and to welcome Dr. Nikki Greene, who I have been looking up to for almost 20 years. As shocking as that may sound, given how young Nikki and I both look, Nikki was a year ahead of me at the University of Delaware, and we actually received our PhDs around the same time, but I have admired her scholarship and her kindness and her generosity for almost 20 years. So I am thrilled to welcome her here today, and let me tell you a little bit about her scholarship. Dr. Nikki Greene is Associate Professor of Art History at Wellesley College and Visiting Scholar at the Kogut Institute for Humanities at Brown University. As one of the inaugural New England Humanities Consortium Faculty of Color Working Group Mellon Fellows. She also serves as an advisor to the ICA Boston for the 59th Venice Biennale presenting of the work Simone Lee for the United States Pavilion in 2022. Wow, amazing. She is the recipient of the Mellon Postdoctoral Fellowship in Art and Africana Studies at Wellesley College, the Woodrow Wilson Career Advancement Fellowship, an artist residency at the UCross Foundation, and the Richard D. Cohen Fellowship at the Hutchins Center for African and African American Research at Harvard University. She is the former visual arts editor of Transition Magazine, published by the Hutchins Center. Her forthcoming book, Grime, Glitter, and Glass, The Body and the Sonic in Contemporary Black Art, which is being published by Duke University Press in 2023, presents a new interpretation of the work of Renee Stout, Radcliffe Bailey, and Maria Magdalena Campos-Pons, and considers the intersection between the body, Black identity, and the sonic possibilities of the visual. And I've been hearing about this work since we were grad students together, so I cannot wait for the book to come out and to transform the field, which I know it will. Dr. Greene's essays have appeared in American Studies Journal, Aperture, Panorama, Journal of the Association of Historians of American Art, among many others. Panorama published her essay, Vibrations of the Soul, The Sacred Paintings of Moe Brooker in 2018. And Panorama is a live, free access journal. You can go find that beautiful article free online with beautiful images. Nikki's also currently organizing an exhibition on contemporary performance art by Black femme artists. And I just want to express our deep gratitude to Nikki for joining us today. Nikki was not only a scholar of Moe's work, but a personal friend of Moe and his wife, who she worked with at the PMA many years ago. And so it is especially moving and poignant that we have Dr. Nikki Greene here today. So thank you, Nikki.
Thank you all so much. Thank you for the introduction and thank you for this invitation. Abby and Anna were very gentle with me as I kind of cautiously said, okay, I'm not really sure if I can give a lecture and not cry. How does one do that? And you'll understand in just a minute as I go through this lecture with you all. And I will say that it's been a work of love and care for me. I actually feel that way pretty strongly about all the artists that I work with, work on, some who have already passed, but also I tend to work with contemporary artists of African descent. And I think in general, my work as an art historian is one that I feel honored and privileged to do. It's a job not many people have, and then it's really not a job that many Black folks occupy. I got here really through the grace of a lot of mentorship, family support, and also care from others, as well as from students. And I am definitely motivated by teaching. And it does feel like a calling for me to teach. And it's a calling for me to write about artists like Moe. And so be patient with me. I want you to be patient with yourselves, especially for those of you who knew Moe. And many of you have also probably already attended memorial services or looked through old photos and videos after his passing in January. I want to also, in honoring his memory, I want to thank Musa and Misha, his children, for trusting me to continue to speak about their father. And if you knew Moe, you knew about his love for those two people, among many, many others. Even though I don't know them well personally, I'm getting to know them. I knew them because as a person who documents the life of an artist and their greatest accomplishments, so are Muse and Misha. And I learned about Moe's death shortly after. So Moe passed away on January 9th. And I couldn't process it right away because my father died on January 7th. And his name was Nathaniel Alexander. And that's a big reason why I thought, there's no way that I can do this. And my father died just 7 months after my mother. He couldn't do it. He couldn't be here without her, which was a beautiful and heart-wrenching process over the last year. But with that said, it's an honor to be able to talk about Moe in the spirit of honoring our ancestors and their transitions, because for many of us, and especially for folks of African descent, we know that our paths are not always laid before us in paved in gold, or paved in paint, or ceramics, or, you know, it's the life of an artist and a person working in the arts is not always an easy one, but it's one that is fueled by passion and fueled by what we'll discuss by the divine. And so I want to be able to make sure that all of that is said and that the way that I talk about Moe today, it's gonna sound a little at times very art speak, very art jargony. And for those of you who aren't necessarily versed in art, I want you to hang in there with me. And there will be a lot of talk of God and the divine, because that was a reflection of Moe and his spirit and his life. And so regardless of your faith, I'm hoping that this hour that we have together will be one that provides a sense of peace and connection and a kind of harmony for us. Now I'm gonna do something with you to start off that's probably a little bit unusual. It's something that I began practicing with my students it actually started before the pandemic. And then once we went remote, once my students kind of had to flee the campus, it became even more important that we start off with just being present and breathing. And so I'm going to invite you all totally voluntarily to just take a moment, lower your shoulders, feel your body in whatever position it's in. If it's on a chair, most of us are sitting on chairs. If you're in a bed, and just get connected to your own body. And I would like us to practice just taking a deep breath in and breathing it out with a whoosh. Okay, so if you'd like to close your eyes, I would invite you to close your eyes, not necessary, but just take a huge breath in at 4, 1, 2, 3, 4, and whoosh. Maybe later I'll do something more elaborate. I don't know, but I guess I just want us to kind of be here and know that you are being seen in your own way, that in fact, we are connecting in some way to the soul of the body. And with that, I'll begin. I'm just going to need to adjust one more time what's happening with my monitor so I can see my notes. You can't see what's going on, but it's going to bother me if I don't. Give me just one moment. Okay, so I came to know Moe's work through his late wife, Cheryl McClenny Brooker, as you heard before. I met Cheryl right after the first year of graduate school at the University of Delaware, when I worked a summer internship with her in the external affairs office. And Cheryl is, like Moe, was a deeply spiritual woman and kind, brilliant, and her mission in the arts was connecting people and giving people platforms, connecting resources, and among many, many other things that I can't quite name. But it was through Cheryl I got to know Moe, and being sort of new to the Philadelphia area, getting to know not only Moe, but also the great community of artists in Philadelphia, of all walks of life, the amazing art schools that are here only fueled the way in which art lives in the city. And I desperately miss Philadelphia. Boston's okay, in case there are any of my Boston people around. Boston's great. It's grown on me over time, but there's something about the spirit of Philadelphia that is unbeatable. And what has been so attractive to me about Moe's work over time was that I was actually very much enamored with abstract painting. And I saw Moe's practice in so many Black artists in particular, who painted abstractly, as a practice and something really quite moving. And I know that so many of you will, if you're not familiar with Moe's work, or if you're not as familiar with abstraction, this can sort of look like foreign material. Like, what am I looking at? And so my job today is to hopefully provide some analysis of that, give you a deeper sense of what's happening on the various surfaces that we're looking at. But I want to recall one event that happened while I was a master's student or getting my master's at University of Delaware. I attended this conference at Franklin and Marshall College in 2004. And it was an exhibition that highlighted and you can kind of see in the outline where you can see some of the names here: Sam Middleton, Mary Lovelace O'Neill, Joe Overstreet, and many, many others. It was such a captivating conference, primarily because these were the biggies, right? A generation of artists who did not, during their lifetime, get their proper due. Some of them are actually still living and working and are beginning to get more of that recognition. But with that, I remember as a nervous master student saying, what do I do now? How do I make my contribution? There was this long table of all of these beautiful artists sitting there. And I remember them saying, you just have to write. And what you're seeing here is the note from Mary Lovelace O'Neill saying, write the stories we need written. Don't wait, start now. And I really took that to heart. This is one of my, I like to have my books signed, but this is very precious, because one of the things that happened was that the artists started walking around and getting each other's signatures. And so anybody who had this catalog would, you know, I'm going to get my signatures. I have this beautiful book with all of these signatures of people, again, some of whom are no longer with us. And to have these beautiful signatures and messages along the way. And there's one that I really appreciate today from John T. Scott, which was remember to remember. And so this is a part of the remembering, and we know to remember our loved ones and to remember those who go on. And for those of us who are able to know artists in our lives, they leave so much for us to remember them by. It's a unique gift to this world. And I know that there are many artists here today, and I appreciate seeing many artists' faces that I do not know, or who I can at least tell are artists. Your work matters regardless of who's showing it, how frequently or not it's shown. You will be remembered. And for Mo, again, I want to stress for him, his practice as memorial, as an honoring was to God. I'm going to read just a short quote by Mo that goes like this. I interviewed Mo on several occasions, but he, and he always gave me little gems. So here's one. God is light. I wasn't looking for the light that comes from something. I was looking for the light contained inside. God is light. The other important thing for me is that God is layers, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Ghost. The combination of color, of light, and of layers began to help me understand. And as that began to develop, the sense of music, which is linear in my mind, began to impact the image. So what began to happen is that a linear structure would be put down, then layers of color and layers of shape. And all of that I found relative to my perception of God, what he is and what he is to me. So Mo would readily tell you, and many know this about him, he freely acknowledges his status as a PK, a preacher's kid, and throughout his more than four decade long, is that right? No, five, probably since birth, you know how you artists are. He's a Philadelphia native, and Mo created a very distinctive artistic language. Here he's standing before a canvas by Norman Lewis, which we'll see recurring in the halls of the Academy today. But his spiritual upbringing and the resultant approach to art making, along with jazz and gospel music, have contributed to the energetic abstract mixed media paintings that we'll look at today. And I argue that Mo represented his faith in the line of Wassily Kandinsky, who we'll get into in terms of there being a spiritual and immaterial way of engaging art. And then that way of systematically practicing abstraction and the implementation of improv, improvisation on the canvas, on the surfaces that he was able to incorporate, be it canvas or paper, and certainly murals as well. I meant to stick in one of the more recent murals that he completed. But for him, he did that as a daily practice of worship, and it was a daily devotion to painting. Mo started off, and he'll tell you that when he attended the Pennsylvania Academy of the Fine Arts and also Tyler School of Art at Temple University, he believed that abstract painters were in fact charlatans. And he took many of his formal cues from realist artists like Thomas Aikens and the Ashcan School of the late 19th and early 20th centuries. And he strove to paint his own experiences and those of the Black community as directly as possible. And so as a young man, a young artist, figural drawing and painting, as you see here, was the most obvious direction for achieving that goal. And, you know, being raised in South Philly as a PK, he really did find his earliest inspiration in the church. His father was a minister in the Philadelphia area. And as a result, he began sketching various characters from the perspective of the pulpit. So imagine the grandmother with children, the old man who slept on the pew each week, the women who are sitting and processing with outstanding regal church hats, right? So keenly aware of the sleek and brilliant wardrobes worn not only in the church, but also in the streets of Philadelphia. You can still find that there. He kept his palette really quite animated. And he was also deeply influenced as a graduate of PAFA. He was influenced by the alum Henry Ossawa Tanner. And Anna Marley's first big show at PAFA was a survey of Tanner's work, and I use it quite often in my classes. It's a great exhibition catalog if you can get your hands on it. And he, Moe, as a young artist, clearly venerated Tanner. I think even today folks should venerate Tanner. Tanner was born in Pittsburgh, and there's a lot of similarity in terms of the journeys of these two very different people in different time. Tanner was born in Pittsburgh, but he grew up and moved to Philadelphia as a child. And he entered PAFA in 1880, where he studied with Thomas Aikens. He traveled to Paris, where he entered the Academie Julien and joined the American Art Students Club. And he also made many trips to Pont-Aven on the Brittany coast, which was substantially less racist than you can imagine than in Philadelphia. And his early paintings, such as the banjo lesson pictured here, were everyday subjects. He also did many seascapes, landscapes, and animal paintings. And of course, also religious paintings. Where there is a sense of a real kind of eerie synergy between the two is that they both uncannily had upbringings in middle-class households anchored to the African Methodist Episcopal Church, the AME Church. And Bethel African Methodist Church, Episcopal Church. Hold on. The Bethel African Methodist Episcopal Church hid many runaways since its establishment in 1793. It partially contributed to the rise of the African-American population in Philadelphia during the late 18th and early 19th century. And Tanner was also a PK. His father, Benjamin Tucker Tanner, served as a minister in the AME Church and was very prominent in the church. And as a result, he held many prominent roles, and he was also, his father was a, served in the AME conference. And so as in that role, he often had to travel from church to church throughout the greater Philadelphia region. And that was sort of required of his of him. And he did that for many, many years. And these seminal factors of being raised in the AME church, and then also, I should mention, I'm actually confusing things. Moe Brooker's father was a part of the AME conference and traveled throughout the greater Philadelphia area until the 1960s. And Tanner remarked in an autobiographical essay, and he said, on September 15th, 1830, hold on, sorry, getting my notes a little askew, hold on. Okay. Give me just a second as my screen decides to freeze up on me. I'll pass by the quote, but essentially what we have in someone like Tanner, who is engaging with the canvas and light, divine light, as it shows up here in the Annunciation scene. And you can see here that it's held at the Philadelphia Museum of Art, but also in the light cast in locations where Tanner was eventually able to travel throughout the Middle East and in throughout Europe. And so it's the kind of practice that you see in Tanner's religious paintings that coordinate with or coincide or have this kind of symbiosis with Moe, even though their canvases look completely different. So the engagement with the divine as light, right? Moe's proclamation that God is light, alongside the kind of laborious working of the canvas also plays into this as well. I encourage you, I won't go through all of the details of that here, primarily because I do go into a little bit more detail in the article. And you, again, you know that you can get that for free on Panorama. But they both had layers upon layers. And what was really brilliant about that 2012 exhibition, the conservationists at PAFA were able to show and demonstrate the many, many levels of Tanner's canvases, layers of paint, and the way he reworked and worked over these thick layers of paint to provide a brilliant surface and depth. And okay, I'm gonna keep going because I can talk about these things all the time. I love looking into artist studios. I'm excited. I'm going to do an artist studio and artist studio visit in Georgia in a couple of weeks. I miss that. And we know that for many artists, the studio is where the magic happens. I think it also happens a lot more in their heads. I'm always like, well, I don't know if I could manage keeping all of the ideas that artists have and being able to express it. Moe developed a practice very early on. He woke up at 5 o'clock every morning to paint. And he first began this daily schedule shortly after the birth of his first child, Moose, in 1973. And he had to teach at night. He took care of his son during the day. And he worked, you know, primarily during his nap time. And Moe remembers this as one of his most productive periods of his career. Hear this. He created 150 works a year for 5 years straight. Complete works. And so within his music-filled studios at home or in one of the converted 19th century textile factories in Philadelphia, he usually played jazz or gospel music as a kind of part of the practice, right? I know many artists use music. That is what I do as a historian. I'm deeply interested in how folks engage with the sonic as a part of their practice. Moe was able to, and what you see in this slide here, he was able to work metamorphose, what starts off as a series of small drawings. And so in the background there, you can see he has different scale of works, and he goes from small drawings. I'm gonna use the present tense. You're gonna have to roll with me. He's still here, right? But he would start off with a series and kind of rework them into different sizes. And these, it was a result of painstaking hours, days, months, sketching, painting, or even just the act of looking, right? That kind of meditation before the canvas. And I really like that we can kind of see here in the background where we see the first layer going down, and it doesn't you don't see in the final product that this is where it begins. And so that building up over time to arrive at something more complete, and then also something that's really richly informed by many, many factors. So let me talk to you about that. He leaned very heavily on his cultural heritage from engaging with African textiles and African-American quilting traditions, as you see here with the kente cloth. He also was interested in the kind of different patterns you have, named patterns in the kente, checkerboards, stepped diagonals. So you can see here very clearly the checkerboard being engaged here. Give me just a second so I can, hold on. So you can see where he has the checkerboard pictured here on the right, the way in which he then, what I kind of describe as sewing together these planes in order to make them come alive as if it were a quilt. He was very much influenced by the Dutch artists, for example, Vermeer, and he talked extensively about looking at the patterns and the way in which he was able to create a sense of depth. For example, looking at the checkerboard pattern here in the artist in the studio, this self-portrait, as it were, of Vermeer, and looking at how you understand and create space in the floors there on your left, that they open up and direct the gaze of the viewer through the composition. I'm just gonna go back here where you can see where the flat floor is actually tilted up, where your eye is led through the canvas into the space behind. Moe did this in through abstraction. He wants to give you that sense of depth where you have to figure out where the foreground and background are. And I mentioned the quilting tradition, something like the Harriet Powers Bible quilt held at the MFA Boston. Still haven't seen it because textiles are precious. I have never seen it out. But you know, taking these different planes and literally sewing them together. Contemporary artists like the late Emma Amos also engaged with fabric here along the edge, and engaging painting and perspective and movement. And of course, the ever brilliant Faith Ringgold, who has a show up at the New Museum, which I hope I get to see. If you're in New York or can get to New York, you will not be disappointed. I remember hearing her speak about her work, and she, one of the reasons why she switched from canvas to these quilts was because it was easier to ship. They're beautiful. And her mother also helped her with the quilting itself, but she could have a whole show in a box, is how she described it. So another element another group of artists is the Giesbind artists, who also became very well known beginning in the 90s. And there was a brilliant show at the Philadelphia Museum of Art that Moe was able to attend and was certainly influenced by and greatly engaged with. And I love this photograph where you see three of the quilters there who are singing gospel music, and lo and behold, in the foreground are, here's Moe standing here and Cheryl, who is seated below. Now, I want to get a little bit more into the analysis here of one of his painting, Ancient Futures. Okay, so far we've got the planes that are metaphorically stitched together with these white lines. And for Brooke, for Moe, he engaged with this work as a kind of what he called an African choice system of color and shape. So in Ancient Futures, he's anchoring the background with that patchwork quality of large rectangles. of vibrant hues of orange, red, green, blue, and black. He says that language has consistently been in place for him. And in most of his paintings, you will see that frenzied text-like line over the canvas. So I'm going to play a slideshow later, and I want you to also see just how well he does that and how that particular language plays out for him. And in the way that he makes these planes shift and move, I've absolutely seen them as a kind of pattern of, if I get there, a pattern of rhythm. And he's had many, many influences, European influences. I'm going to go fairly quickly through them so that I can kind of get to some sound here. But from Giotto's Arena Chapel to Kandinsky, he's engaging with these artists of the 20th century as well, like Hans Hofmann and Arshil Gorky, who are also playing with shapes and color and rhythmic positioning. But again, for Moe, there is this element of the divine, of a kind of African-American sensibility. And certainly with that comes also the influence of musicians like Miles Davis and John Coltrane, artists like Cy Twombly and Sam Gilliam. Sam Gilliam was of African descent as well. He knew Al Loving very well. And I know that he really looked up to Mr. Loving and his work, which was also abstract and a bit more sculptural. Raymond Saunders as well, someone who Moe really admired. And of course, I mentioned Kandinsky, who had these in a book called Concerning the Spiritual in Art. I'm going to quickly quote here from a chapter he called The Psychology of Color. And in that, Kandinsky says the following: generally speaking, color is a power which directly influences the soul. Color is the keyboard, the eyes are the hammers, the soul is the piano with many strings. The artist is the hand which plays, touching one key or another to cause vibrations in the soul. And Kandinsky also engaged with the checkerboard pattern and shifting planes as well. And for Moe, his early abstractions included shapes, diagonals, bars, but also he more heavily relied on the color of the black color to anchor his works. And even though spontaneous, right, they look almost graffiti-like. Again, I don't want to overlook this element of daily practice, of building up on a theme, building up on a certain level of skills that provide a sense of spontaneity. Our great musicians have not, I know I'm passing by a few here, but they didn't arrive to where they were by just twiddling around, right? They built up a patterning of playing, learning the composition, learning note by note what to do, going to PAFA, going to Tyler School of Art, teaching in a way that I know generations of students have appreciated the way in which daily practice can influence an artist's work. And so he was, Moe was very much enthralled with the work of Coltrane. And I'm going to play here just a short bit of Coco, which was recorded November 26, 1945. And it was recorded at the Savoy Records and is said to be the first recording of bebop. And Moe really enjoyed bebop and it had a great impact on him. Thank you. love to do more. I've talked about Buford Delaney before. I'm actually going to pass by that for the sake of time, because I want to make sure that we have a chance to talk and engage with some questions. I love this photo. Again, I love the artist studio, but here you get to see how many different kinds of materials he's using. He was interested in materiality of oil, encaustic, collage, colored pencils, pastels, and he was interested in the way they related to each other, both physically and also metaphysically, in a way that could provide that sense of almost a transcendence through those shifting panes, shifting planes that I mentioned before. And Mo said that painting is worship for him, right? So it's a holy meditation, and in quoting him in the painting process as a daily devotion, as I mentioned before, he said, it's almost like a prayer. And what passes through me is not of my own invention. It comes from the higher being. It's not church. This is my private worship. And for this reason, he signed his works TTGG to the glory of God in every single panel. Hold on a second. So he represents his faith in the Kandinskian sense, spiritually, immaterially, in the resonances of the chords of orange beneath lavender, shifting under the blue and black checkerboard, pastel blue dashes, seeming black and orange and green and ochre planes together, nodes of irregularity shape circles from the whole color spectrum. They dance in harmony with one another. If his paintings are as multi-layered and complex as the people who have the opportunity to encounter them, then like the true son of a preacher, he plays the keys, hoping to cause the vibration of your soul. And just as a reminder, the soul is the body of the spirit. I want to encourage those of you who are in the Philadelphia area to visit the corridor where Moe's work now hangs. This is a photograph from on the day of the memorial, that the beautiful memorial that PAFA hosted. And this here is Moose. And it's currently hanging in the original building. And he is in good company with Norman Lewis there on the right, that white and red canvas you see there, and Jacob Lawrence on the left. And I love the placement too, because he's in conversation with the founding father of the Peel and the Peel family there in the background. And I think that Mo would be quite pleased with the way this was hung. Thank you, curators. And also, I want to remind us that as the soul is the body, and as we kind of, I'm going to close out here with a song, that we honor the people we love in a number of ways. And to be able to, again, I want to reiterate the gifts they leave behind. I know for me, I value now the little notes that I find with my mother's hand written signatures, or finding a photo of my father with my kids. And this is a way that we can reach him, reach Mo, reach Cheryl, reach those who haven't been able to be with us today. I want to honor those people in your life who you are missing, be it family, friends, or family from scratch, AKA family. And I'm going to invite us once again to take a deep breath. And I'm going to close you out with a duet so that we can hear from Mo and his late wife, Cheryl McKaylee Brooker. And they were devout Christians. They had amazing voices. And they were also a part of a group called the Royal Priesthood, which included his sister, Dr. Vivian Ford. And I will play that now.
So why don't you take all those burdens to the
I'm sorry, Nikki, but we aren't able to hear the audio.
Hold on. You can't hear the audio now?
Very muffled.
Oh, okay. It worked before, huh?
Mm-hmm.
Why don't I...
Maybe if you mute yourself, Nikki.
Oh, that's...
You want to try that?
Okay.
That might be it.
All right. Take two.
So why don't you take
No, I'm sorry, it cut out again. But you can hear the first couple of bars, and I think it's a beautiful sentiment. And it's okay now, and you're still muted, Nikki.
That's the first time it didn't work.
You want to try one more time, Nikki?
It's worth it. It's worth it.
Let's try it one more time. And if it doesn't work, then we'll move on. But let's try it one more time.
You know what I'll do? I'll take it out of presenter view.
And while you're setting that up, I want to first thank you, Matt or Margie, for who said that it's okay. The paintings say it all. I think it's to see the beauty. And just know, folks, that we'll have just a couple minutes together afterwards. So if you have questions or thoughts, please put them in the chat now, and we'll try to get to a couple of them.
Okay, it's not letting me share anymore, so that's fine.
Yeah, well, that was fantastic. I'm sorry that it ended not quite on the high note, but it was amazing to see so much work and your passion for Moe Brooker's legacy. And also thank you all so much for the positive things you're putting in the chat and the wonderful things you're sharing. I saw several great questions. One of which stuck out to me, asking about if Moe had traveled abroad and if there was influences. Mm-hmm.
Yes, Moe was actually in the military. And one of the influences that I didn't mention was that he was in Korea, and he was deeply affected by Korean funeral services, which are very multicolored and brilliant. He spent time, let's see, I need to jump in here. I believe they've taken trips to Japan. They took the kids, I know, to several places. So yes, he traveled a lot. He traveled all over the world.
That's amazing. Thank you.
Anna? I saw a lot of people asking about if Emma Amos and Mo knew each other and if there was a relationship with them.
I assume it's a small world. I know they knew of each other, and I'm sure they were in the same circles, but I'm not familiar with them having a kind of deep personal friendship. I would say someone like Al Loving, and then certainly there is a whole cadre of Philadelphia artists who were also, I actually thought about writing about Philadelphia artists or doing an exhibition at some point. There were several artists, for example, who were at the beautiful memorial last month. And so I'm thinking about artists who presented there, like Richard Watson, Andy Webster, who was a gallerist, a prominent gallerist for artists of color in Philadelphia, James Brantley. I mean, there's so many who just in the Philadelphia area, they were very tight-knit group, so.
Yeah, we have someone in the chat also mentioning that potentially Emma Amos and Mo met each other through the Brandywine workshop since they
both- Oh, right, yeah.
Alan Edmonds through that.
Of course, of course.
I was really taken with, you know, the connections with Emma Amos, but also who just had the wonderful exhibition at the PMA, but also the connections to other exhibitions that have been at PAFA in the Philadelphia region with the Norman Lewis Show and the Tanner, kind of seeing all of those things come together. Yeah. I also wanted to make sure to give space to Musa, who mentioned that they were here and said that they were having, you're welcome to unmute if you would like to say anything as well. Yeah.
Yes, I just wanted to jump in and say that he in terms of travel, he went to China and taught. He went to the Netherlands for a show with, I believe it was the Netherlands, with Ray Shaché, an art group of Black artists that he was a part of. So he did, and he traveled. He won the Crescent Award at PAFA and traveled to Europe and studied there. And he also, he studied in Rome when he was at Tyler. My mother actually went with him during that trip. So they lived abroad. I've got these amazing pictures of them and lots of stories of them overseas when they lived there. Sometimes my mother still throws in some Italian words when she's speaking. And the other thing that I did want to say that I mentioned in sort of going through his studio, I found a real gem. Nikki, first of all, thank you for this. It's amazing. And thank you to PAFA for hosting this. You mentioned that he was in the military and he went to Korea in the 60s. And in going through his studio, I actually found his diary from when he was in the service in Korea from 1964 to 1966.
Oh, it's my like, gosh.
This amazing find. I cannot believe that I found it. It was just sitting there on his shelf. This is a real treasure.
Oh, that's wonderful. I forgot to mention that Mo, Bill Valerio at the Woodmere Art Museum and I were already in conversation since 2019 about doing a survey of his work and mounting an exhibition. And then the pandemic hit. So I know it was a goal for Mo, and I think he deserves every inch of a wall that a museum can provide to see that scale. So I can just imagine, you know, having this element of Korea, and there's so many elements to his life. He lived such a full life that the possibilities are endless, so.
And I do want to mention that I have been in touch with Bill Bellario, and he's still the Woodmere is still committed to having that retrospective. So just in conversation with him about that. So.
Yeah. Nikki, I saw that our president, Eric Pryor, put his camera on, which made me think that he might want to say something. And Eric, I'm sorry if I'm putting you on the spot at the end of lunch, but I saw it turn on.
That's okay. I truly enjoyed the talk, Dr. Greene. Thank you so much. It was just great. Enjoyed learning more about Mo's work and his influences. And I'm always excited when I see you know, when you see personal influences of yours, people may know I had a super close relationship to Al Loving. I call him my art father. Mm-hmm. And to see, you know, how Al touched so many people, including Mo, it's always just, you know, for me, just brings a smile. Thank you again for, you know, just sharing so much about his work. And we're honored to have his have Moe's work hang in the historic landmark building at PAFA. Thank you. Thank you, Dr. Marlin.
Thank you.
And thank you, Dr. Green.
Thanks so much.
Thank you for being here with us. And thank you all so much for the supportive and beautiful tributes that you're putting in the chat and for holding the space with us. I want to make sure that Dr. Green gets to say the final goodbye to everybody, but I just wanted to thank you so much, Nikki, for being here with us. And it's been amazing learning more about Moe's life and work and legacy.
Thank you. Thank you all for your attention, taking the time out of your day to be in communion together. And I hope that this message of the divine, however it shows up in your life, comes through, and there will be more. You will be hearing more about Moe and his work. And thank you for holding the space for me today.
Thank you so much, Nikki, and thank you for all you offer to us in giving us a space, particularly so many of us who, like you, have lost people in this past few years.
Take care. Holding you all in my heart. Be well.
Bye, Nikki.